Hello. So I am out in the middle of the woods going to read my first book to you guys, and it's called Cinnabar, the 1 o'clock fox. And here's a picture. That's a fox. It's one of my favorite books. Now you can see that I'm out here in the woods. I'm going to turn my camera around so you can see a lot of the places where I'm at. Okay, now we're back to me. Foxes live in woods. In fact, in these woods, there are foxes that live there. So what I'm going to do right now is I'm going to start reading Cinnabar, the 1 o'clock fox. Okay, let's see. I think that'll work. Yeah, and you might be able to hear some things also. All right. Of course, that sound is not a fox, is it? Chapter 1. 4 is a jolly nice number. It was April in Virginia. The brooks and runs on George Washington's estate were overflowing in their hurry to join the big Potomac. Pussy willows along the banks were swollen to plumpness, and everywhere the woods and meadows were alive with cheeps and cheerings and little feet scampering. One morning, just before the break of dawn, when the moon was still shining brightly, 4 little fox cubs were born in a den tucked away in a sassafras thicket. Cinnabar, their father, had been out all night hunting. He wanted to bring a nice plump hen to his wife because she liked nice plump hens. And if ever there was a time to please Vicky, as he called her, it was now, this very night. Cinnabar's mask-like face with its slanted amber eyes looked up at the great white face of the moon, but that is not what he saw. He saw instead the warm coziness of his own den, and there was Vicky, still busy at the nest box, weaving a mattress of grasses and reeds. He knew what that meant. It meant furry little foxes, any moment now. He bayed his happiness to the moon. Yup-yur, yup-yur. He disappeared into a tangle of honeysuckle and hauled out the fat hen that he had cached away an hour before. Then he pawed deeper into the tangle wood and gathered up 4 good-sized barn mice. He took them one at a time and placed them side by side, neatly and securely, underneath the hen's wings. My stars and garters, he barked to himself. It's been a capital night for hunting. Grabbing the hen's neck in his mouth, he flung her over his shoulder and trotted off toward home. Cinnabar was a big, red, magnificent fellow. Courage and heart showed in the very look of him. A rough scar across his nose and a nick on one ear in no way marred his handsomeness. On the contrary, they gave him a gay and gallant air. They spoke of battles won over eagles and buzzards and hawks and weasels. Cinnabar was, in truth, afraid of nothing, neither of dark nor of storm, nor of hunters nor hounds. He was free and unwearying, unfearing, the very spirit of the wilds. With a wind-blown movement, he went gliding along, his brush of a tail stretched out full, his lively ears pricked to and fro, catching every sound of the night, pine needles singing, frogs playing their bassoons, birds beginning to stir and twitter. It seemed to him that the morning was coming in with a peculiar gladness. Silently, he left the big trees behind and trotted down a little avenue of hemlocks. Fast as he traveled, his imagination went faster still. He could almost hear Vicky's cry of delight when she spied not only the plump hen, but the 4 good mice as well. How she likes hens and mice, he mused. Better than grouse and grasshoppers. Better than anything except me, he chuckled as he shifted his burden to the other shoulder. Chatting and laughing and happy in himself, he threaded his way through the sassafras thicket that hid his den. But as he approached the opening, he stopped dead. What were those strange sounds? He thought he heard small trills and whimperings. Criminy, criminy, and by Jiminy, he exploded. I must be a father. I hear puppy voices. Unmistakably, I do. Parting the ferns that screened the doorway, he pattered softly through them. Then wriggling forward on his belly, he bunted the hen down the dark entry and finally emerged into the warm comfort of his own den. He blinked his eyes at the brightness. A wick burning in an oyster shell gave off a yellow light, and the fire in the grate was a red glow. That you, Cinny? A voice came, muffled. In reply, Cinnabar barked two sharp barks and one long. It was a family signal, and it meant good hunting tonight. He saw Vicky now, up on one elbow, half sitting, half reclining in the nest box. And he could hear her tongue strokes, licking, licking, licking. Little shivers of excitement raced up and down his spine. How many pups would there be this time? 2, 4, 9, 12? I shall be quite content with 3, he told himself as he took a step closer. And I hope they all have blue eyes. Blue eyes bewitch me. Vicky was eager to tell about her babies. She gave 4 quick, happy barks. Oh, 4 is a jolly nice number, Cinnabar assured her. 'Twill be easy to provide for them. He laid the big white hen in a splash of firelight, hoping Vicky would notice. But she was concerned only with her young ones. My dear, said Cinnabar with a proud grin, have you thought of names for the funny snub-nosed things? Cinnabar, they are not funny snub-nosed things. Oh, yes, they are, she laughed, contradicting herself all in the same breath. Well, anyway, I've named the 2 little boys. So, asked Cinnabar, shoving the hen closer. Yes, and I do hope you like family names. For instance, Rascal my brother and Pascal for my father. I like them indeed, Cinnabar nodded in approval as he plucked at his whiskers thoughtfully. Then reaching into the nest box, he fondled the fuzzy little creatures. How about Merry and Mischief for the vixens, he asked, looking all merry and mischievous himself. Vicky sighed in envy. How do you do it? It took me hours to think up Rascal and Pascal, and you thought up Merry and Mischief just like that. It was nothing, Cinnabar said modestly. Nothing at all. I once knew some people by those names. And how shall you spell Mary? Vicky asked as she settled deeper into the nest box. Mary or Merry? Oh, the latter way. For if she is anything like you, my dear, that would fit her the better. And now, if you will tell me where you've put the wild duck eggs, I shall prepare us a breakfast that is a breakfast. Meanwhile, you just go on with your licking and nursing. Vicky gave a sigh of contentment. The wild duck eggs, she said, are buried in the sand down in the cellar. The den of Cinnabar was as snug and well-furnished as one could find in all Virginia. It was sleeping chamber, library, dining room, and kitchen all in one. A round flat stone fitted onto a stump-like growth made a nice dinner table, and the seats around it were the twisted roots of a tree. Natural rock made the chimney piece, and above the mantel hung a gaily decorated map of Cinnabar's hunting territory, while on either side were bookcases stacked with friendly books bound in birch bark. On the mantel shelf was an hourglass, a 3-minute glass, and several quaint pieces of drift that Cinnabar had picked up along the Potomac. An old-time chair sat on barrel-stave rockers. An old-time chair set on barrel-stave rockers stood in one corner near the fireplace, and in the other was the nest box. The only touches of color were the pale green ivy that clambered over the latticed roots of the ceiling and a sweet potato vine sprouting from a hanging basket. Cinnabar's eyes roved with pleasure about his home. Then they fell upon the hen lying at his feet. He could restrain himself no longer. My dear, he exclaimed, what think you of this white biddy? What think you of her? I caught her amidst the wildest turmoil in Deacon Doolittle's hen house. Oh, Cinnabar, how could you? Deacon Doolittle has been so good to you. Remember the time when you were a young pup and the hounds were after you and he threw his jacket over you and picked you up bodily until they were gone? I do indeed, so I did him a good turn too. I caught 4 mice in his corn crib and here they are. Flipping back the hen's wings, he exposed the 4 fat mice with their 9 teeth quite visible. Vicky sat bolt upright. Cinny, you are wonderful. Simply wonderful. You always do more to help the farmer than to hurt him. But I'm not up to preparing a big meal today. Let's have it tomorrow. Pleased and proud, Cinnabar pulled the hen over to the stairway and pushed her down. I'll pluck her later, he promised himself. Breakfast preparations now went on with great slap and dash. Cinnabar never could understand why Vicky made such work of it. He ran gaily down to the cellar and sniffed his way to a small sandbar. Scooping in among the grains of sand, he uncovered 2 wild duck eggs. Then back up the stairs he went, bounding on his hind legs and hugging the eggs with his forepaws. He felt good. The fire was crackling merrily. Vicky was making little snoring sounds, and the pups were squirming and suckling. Humming an old hunting tune, he reached for the skillet hanging beside the mantel. He tossed some goose grease into it, cracked the eggs against the fireplace, and plopped them into the pan. The yolk stayed whole, and they were like big, bulgy eyes looking up at him. Funny thing, he winked right back at them. The rougher you treat eggs, the less apt they are to break. But coddle them, and the yolks squish all over. Coddle them, the thought struck him. Why not? Yes, he would coddle them. Vicky liked them that way. He looked at her tenderly. It must be tiring having pups. He was glad he was a dog fox. Hunting was his life, and being hunted, he liked danger, excitement, and adventure. It made him feel every inch a fox. The eggs were sending up a delicious fragrance. They were nice and strong and old. I like my eggs high, he mused as he tossed them up and over and caught them back in the skillet pan. Vicky, he called, wake up and feast upon wild duck eggs. Coddled. Vicky covered her cubs with a puff of thistledown and came yawning happily across the den. She noticed that the eggs were fried, not coddled, but she was so glad to have someone do the cooking for her that she said not a word. Cinnabar now slid each egg into a beech leaf, and next he studied the relish bottles, reading their labels aloud. Grasshoppers, red-legged beetles, crickets. Drooling in delight, he shook some beetle into his paw, crunched them to a fine powder, and sprinkled it all over the eggs. Then he and Vicky sat down to table. If you please, Cinnabar, may I have a smidgen more of the beetle seasoning? I love the bittersweet taste and the crunchiness. Cinnabar burst out laughing. Remember, my dear, when you refuse seasonings and sauces of any kind? What a gourmet you have turned out to be. And all because of you, Cinny. You taught me that a dash of this or that is the difference between a dull meal and a delicious one. Which reminds me, would you please get down that volume of unfamiliar quotations? I think I can put my paw on the very one I want. And while you are up, she added, please to bring me my spectacles. In my haste to get into the nest box, I think I dropped them underneath. Cinnabar obliged. Let me see. Vicky pawed through the pages and found one marked with a slice of bacon. Here it is. Listen, my dear. She took a nibble of the bacon. Then adjusting her glasses, she read in her lilting voice, oh, the little more and how much it is, and the little less and what worlds away. Cinnabar stopped lapping the egg yolk and scratched his ear reflectively. My sentiments exactly. Exactly. And it doesn't apply to just sauces and seasonings. Of course not. It applies to the big things, like doing everything real good. Real well, you mean. All right, chuckled Cinnabar. I mean putting your heart and soul into things. Whether it's hunting or being hunted. And I mean doing a jot and a tittle more than is expected of you. Oh, Cinny, I love you more each day. Aw, you just love my cooking, he teased. Vicky's eyes took on a faraway look. If only we can bring up our little ones to face life bravely the way you do. She put on her glasses once again and eagerly flipped through the pages, talking as she looked. I don't mean they need to be quite as daring as you, Cinny, so that hunters can count on them exactly at 1 o'clock. They don't need to be that brave. Her voice faded away as she found the passage she was looking for. This time she read only to herself. Cowards die many times before their deaths. The valiant never taste of death but once. Silently she repeated the lines, tapping her dainty black foot to emphasize them. They fit Cinnabar to a T, she thought, as she nodded to his resolute words. We not only can teach our cubs to be brave, we will!